And so we incorporated these parameters into the Bayesian hierarchical modeling framework. And what we did was we were able to incorporate river-specific random effects on both K and L infinity, and also include climate uncertainties into these as fixed effects on, again, both the L infinity and K parameters. So I mentioned we had climate data. All of it was gathered for and prepared for us by the Gulf of Maine Research Institute. The hindcasted temperatures we used were from 1981 to 2018, and they were compiled from NOAA's Octome Interpolation Sea Surface Temperature Data Set. And you saw a nice graph earlier showing that northeast large marine ecosystem. And so that was the area from Bay of Fundy to Cape Lookout, North Carolina. And we just decided on this region because of many studies that are suggesting shad are mixing and traveling together in the ocean, moving from the Gulf of Maine in the fall between the southern Long Island and Nantucket shoals in the winter, and then as far south as North Carolina in the late winter and spring months. So here are some of our results. This is going to be the coastwide growth curve that we got. So on your x-axis is your age in years. Your y-axis is the total length in centimeters. These gray dots represent individuals at each age and their total length. And then the blue line is the mean, and the red dashed lines are your 95% credible intervals. And so this is, you know, again, for all 12 populations. And so as I said, we could pull out specific populations from this, and that's what we have here. So again, if you have your same axis, the age in years on the x, and total length in centimeters on the y, and I just pulled two out of here. Obviously 12 can be a bit much on one slide, so we just have these two here, and I just wanted to show these two specifically because you can see that there's a lot of variability in these two systems. So the Santee River is a several pairs population, and that Hudson River is along the northern extent of that interoparous population. So the nice thing about having that initial coastwide growth curve is that we can actually fill in the gaps for these systems. So where there's data limited ages, we were able to fill in those gaps and could make some sort of assumption based on those. And so I mentioned that we had all this climate data. So so we have the temperature increasing on the x-axis, and we have your von Willebrandy parameters on the y-axis. You have K on your left and L infinity on your right. And one thing you can obviously see from all this is that as K, as temperature is increasing, K is also increasing, but L infinity is decreasing. So in fish, on average, are decreasing in that mean asymptotic maximum length. But one thing I really want to mention, especially about K here, is that it's not a growth rate. So just because it's increasing with temperature, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're growing faster. It could just mean that they are able to reach this decreasing L infinity a bit faster than they would normally. So if everything we found remains true so far, that rising temperatures are accelerating this growth but decreasing that mean asymptotic maximum length, then that's been known to actually have negative impact with longevity. So due to negative empirical relationships that K has with mortality, this could mean a decrease in, an increase in K could mean a decrease in that natural mortality. And along with this, smaller fish with a decreased lifespan could mean the less eggs for those semilparous fish that we have that only have that single spawn. And it could mean a decrease in those total number of spawns that the interoparous fish have. And both of these have a big, a potential negative impact on on population numbers. And finally, one small thing I wanted to mention is that it's for smaller fish, it could result in significant delays at dams that and that could influence the population in that restricting shad to areas in the river where there's a more viable spawning grounds. So what's next? I said before we had around 56,000 fish in 12 systems. Well, that was done in about August, and now we have a lot more data rolling in. So we're talking, when I last looked, around 140,000 fish to squeeze into this model and 30 river systems. So this has grown quite a bit. And so what you just saw is we had showed the staff assessment committee, and so we came up with some ways to make these models even better. So first we decided, well, we're going to keep the model and the entire population, but we also wanted to include sex-specific models. So one thing you might notice, especially on that Hudson River model that I showed, is that the fit doesn't quite look right. And so this could be fixed maybe by splitting up those bucks and rows. And that will also help hopefully clear up any debate if fish are actually larger in one ecosystem or another, or if females are really driving up that affinity. So it's just going to help make a clearer picture in general of what's happening with fish growth in each population. Next, there was expressed interest in dividing fish up into regional categories based on their reproductive strategies. So we have three splits right now. We're looking at Florida, the Cape Fear to the Hudson River, and then north of the Hudson River to the Canadian border. So this is going to cover your semi-paris fish, your southern iteroparis fish, your northern and your northern iteroparis fish. So this will allow us, say, for that Santee River model that you saw, it allows us to fill in the gaps with other semi-paris populations and not those northern iteroparis fish that it doesn't quite seem realistic for them to be reaching the same parameters. And finally, I mentioned we use scale ages here. I think that we're kind of leaning more in general towards one of the age. We're including both, but it seems like the bulk of the project is going to be a photolith from now on. And finally, I just wanted to talk a little bit about Shadia, our package that we're working on. It's a dam passage performance standard model, and Dan's giving a talk on it tomorrow in more in depth. But I thought I'd mention it and include how we're integrating climate change into these models. So we're using Shadia to help project river-specific populations on an individualized level for up to 50 years. And this is running on spatial and temporal components. So not only did the Gulf of Maine Research Institute provide us with hindcast temperatures, they also gave us temperature projections. And they're actually working on river-specific projections as well right now. So the ocean temperatures are important for determining these growth parameters, and I mentioned earlier a lot of the benefits to understanding these parameters, especially it has the ability to determine multiple different aspects of life, including the dam passage success. And then these river temperatures are going to be important to us for multiple reasons. So first, it has the ability to affect when fish can enter the river. So this is important for both species, of course, but especially for these semi-paris fish who are already entering the river before their gonads are completely developed. Second, it affects how much time we have or the fish have to get up the river. So they have to get up the river, get past the dams, get into a viable spawning ground. And if you're iteroparis, you gotta go back past these dams and you have to make it back out to the ocean. So if there's some sort of time dependency here, that could really affect. And finally, juvenile survival. It's believed that during their out migration, shad actually lose their ability to regulate freshwater ions. So if there's some sort of time-dependent constraint due to the warming temperatures, plus all these other factors like dam passage complications, this could really have a huge problem for juvenile survival. So our hope by including all of this into the model is that we can future prepare for these kinds of effects and make management decisions that are resilient to these kinds of changes in the future. So here's a list of all the people who helped with the project, Jeff Kipp and all the others at the ASMFC who are team at the Gulf of Maine Research Institute, who have been awesome to work with, providing us with all this climate data. And that's a list of all the agencies that provided data for this project, and obviously this has grown. This is just for the data that you saw today. And finally, NOAA for providing